The original intent of this film was to capture the history of a building known today by most as the mill. What this film has become instead is a snapshot of some of the people whose lives would have been quite different were it not for the existence of that building. Some of the folks we'll see and their reasons for being in this film range from the complex and long-lasting family associations of the Dinsmores to the more basic of reasons of longtime area resident Kempton Toby. But for at least one, it came down to something as simple as the pigeons that nest in the mill's rocky foundations. Indeed, branch mills and those who call it home would not likely exist today had a dam and the mill above not been erected on a remote branch of the Sheepscot River. The land on which the mill was built was originally part of the 5th Range of the town of Harlem, and was first owned by a man named Nathan Winslow. The land was then conveyed to John Johnson around 1800. The first reference to the existence of a mill is during this time, as the pond partially formed by the mill was at that time called the Johnson Mill Pond. We now call it Branch Pond. The mill went through several more owners until in 1819 it was bought by 5 men, Robert Payton, Stephen Jones, Stephen Jones Jr., Edward Whitehouse, and Joseph Hacker. Ownership was later consolidated to Mr. Hacker, who then passed it on to his son-in-law, Joseph Greeley. During this time, the mill became a combined grist and sawmill. With Mr. Greeley's retirement, his son-in-law, Thomas Dinsmore, took over the mill.
There's an old map, an atlas, and in the atlas it shows in 1887 or 1889 the grist and carding mill of Greeley and Dinsmore. So that at that time it was a grist and carding mill.
The Dinsmore family retained ownership of the mill for more than a century. Tom and Don Dinsmore, who were interviewed for this film, were the last of the Dinsmores to own the property before ownership was recently conveyed to the Coombs family. At 11 a.m. on June 26th of 1908, a fire broke out in the mill and raged out of control for nearly 3 hours. It destroyed most of the businesses in town, including the mill and many village homes.
And that burned way up to the what we call the cane house. It was next to ours.
Fiery disaster would strike branch mills for a second time. Freda Bradstreet, Palermo's oldest resident, recalls the second fire, which occurred only a handful of years after the first.
The second fire that was so important to us was when our house burned. And that was, I was 4 years old then, and it had started around, there was a man who lived by himself, and he had, it wasn't very complimentary, but they always called his house the shack. Because maybe that's what it looked like. Mm-hmm. And he had a chimney fire. And, of course, back in those days, all they had were neighbors and pails of water. And I don't know if I remember it or whether I've heard people mention it so many times, but I was just getting up from my nap in the afternoon, and I sat in the high chair in the kitchen watching the people bringing their pails, and one man would stand at the sink and pump just as fast as he could pump. And when he got too tired, you know, he would just pass his space to the one in back of him and grab a pail.
In 1914, the mill was rebuilt, bringing new hope to the town. Frieda shares her memories of some of the mill's newest inhabitants.
When I was in grammar school, I'd go by there every day, and in the spring, the mother pigeon would build a nest, or have one, on the rocks under the dam there. And if you go by it today even, you can see all the ledges that are underneath there. And what we would watch, once in a while, one of the nests would drop down into the water or into the rocks. It was quite near the water there. So that was when we would go down and get the pigeons, bring them home, and they would stay with us, you know, until they got old enough to fly, and then away they'd go. So, but the one that I had the longest, I had called Mary Pickford and Charlie Chaplin. And they were real tame. In fact, they were so tame, they flew into the kitchen once when the stove was real hot, and they both burned their feet on the stove. Oh, well. And of course, we had to doctor them, wrap the feet up, and it healed, and so on and so forth. And then I don't remember where we went, but I was gone for the day, and I come back. And I said, where's Mary? And where's Charlie? And my folks said, probably they flew away. But I found out afterwards our puppy had made short work of them.
The mill looked quite different then than it does now, as did the town around it. Some of the area's longtime residents can tell you.
That extension that's out towards the road on the mill now wasn't there years ago. And when they built the bridge, the new bridge in there, they put a temporary bridge where that building is now, in addition to it. And I was with my mother riding down there with a horse and wagon, and this horse didn't want to cross that bridge. But after a while, after she pretty bad and falls a few times, you run right across it. The planks would rattle. They probably was only 2 inch hemlock, or three inch hemlock.
The highway between Palermo and Augusta wasn't paved. And in the winter, you know, it wasn't plowed very much. And in the spring, it was too muddy for anybody to travel on it, really. So we walked.
In 1935, Kenneth Dinsmore added the water-powered sawmill. It was during this time that the current mill reached its working peak. Route 3 still passed directly through town, and demand for the goods produced at the mill was high. Kempton Toby worked delivery for the mill at this time, braving the dangers of a dirt Route 3, and fondly remembers the truck he drove those many years ago.
Okay, this 1942 Chevy, when we bought here, my father bought in South China, Suburban Sales, first day of January, 42. It was right after the war, with the Fed War. And people told me that the government would have to have that truck, because they needed it all. If it didn't have all the miles on it, well, I said, I'll jack that thing up and run it, get some miles on it. But I drove it day and night, you know, a lot, long days, 5 o'clock in the morning, lots of times 10 at night.
The commercial use of the mill ended in the early 60s when it began to be used only for storage. Whether operating or not, over the years the Dinsmores have selflessly maintained the mill, facing fines and paying taxes on a building that generated no revenue.
Annual property tax and it's also insurance, if you choose to put insurance on it, maintenance, repairs, because the biggest thing has been no revenue coming in off it. And it's a big responsibility because we've been maintaining the dam for all of the users of the pond, be it camp owners, or for fire protection, or for fishermen, or environmentalists, canoeists, and people like to hunt, all that. So we were not getting revenue off that and didn't really see how I was trained such a way to put it in any kind of use that it could even begin to capture the cost of keeping the mill up.
There were leaks in the dam and the gates needed to be maintained, and knowing it had to be done, my father, I think at the time, had hired someone to come to remove the debris in front of the dam and do the things that needed to be done so that we could seal it to keep the water level where it should be. And somebody from DEP stepped in to say that we couldn't do that without getting a permit from them. And it seemed odd that what you were trying to do is to preserve the impound, what is in the lake, and not doing it for any, at that time, there was no more sawing going on. We were using it for storage. So we weren't doing it, we were not doing it for any financial gain, but trying to maintain the lake. And then being, it was suggested at the time that there would be a sizable fine for doing this and putting equipment down there without permission and that type of thing. So there was a lot that went on with doing what you felt an obligation to do and receiving no compensation for doing it. But eventually, I think you might have gone and talked with them, or somebody went and talked with them, and the fine was reduced.
On November 30th, 1979, the mill was entered on the National Register of Historic Places. This was in recognition of its historic importance as the only operable water-powered mill left in the state capable of serving the dual purpose of gristmill and sawmill.
Because I happened to be at the store at the time when a gentleman named Frank Beard came in from Maine Historical Preservation, and he worked with Earl Shuttleworth, who I think is still connected to historic preservation, and he asked if he could see the mill. He'd been told about the mill, and I went over and showed him what I could about the mill, and he said that the mill conformed to all the criteria to be put on the National Register of Historic Places in the three or four different categories it could fall in. It met each one of the criteria, and he asked if they made out the paperwork, if we would sign the paperwork, and they would put it on the National Historic Register, which he explained would mean that it would take precedence over any development around, that it would secure the roadbed. They couldn't enlarge the road or do anything because the mill would take, again, the precedence. And one thing that I enjoyed when he was there, though, is when he left the store at the time, Dow's store was operating and ours was operating and the village was a little more vibrant than it is now. He said this is what a Maine village is supposed to look like. So it had a very good feeling at that time.
Years passed and the Dinsmores continued to quietly maintain the building.
When we're talking about the dam itself, we've kept the mill in its historical state, never taking or changing any of the equipment, never taking the belting out or the gears or anything of that note, hoping that the right person would come along to either put it into a museum operation or a working museum. But we never really considered that someone would come along who was a millwright, who would have the ability to put the mill back into operation as a historical building. Now is very historically minded, very much looking to make this as much to period as possible with period equipment running it just the way it was intended to be. He's commented that low water level doesn't help him at all because he can't operate the building with low water. And he knows there will be a level that will be acceptable to the state that it could go as a minimum. So he's going to work towards that.
I hope the public will be supportive of the Coombs family in their endeavor to bring back a type of manufacturing that would go, and with interest in organic farming and so forth, and small-scale farming. And I'm very hopeful it can be successful, and hope the public will be supportive of it and try to work with him and whatever current concerns they have, environmental, whatever it is.
The newest owners, Stephen and Christine Coombs, have big plans for the old mill.